Hello, my name is Paul Cairns, and I'm here to talk to you today about the experience of playing digital games. More specifically, about what it means to become immersed in a good game, and why you shouldn't feel guilty about playing games like The Legend of Zelda. Digital games have something of a bad press. Lots of people level accusations of them, for instance, things like they're misleading versions of reality. They're not the real world. People are escaping into these strange, wonderful worlds and doing very odd things. Moreover, they're doing these things on their own. They're isolating themselves from other people, and as a result of which, they're losing out on the rich social contact of the real world. Not only that, some games quite genuinely do have very immoral content, but by extension, some of this is believed to be true of all games, that they're just really very bad for people and misleading and present a false view of how other people work and therefore lead to people having bad behavior. Of course, the archetype of this is violent video games, for instance, things like Grand Theft Auto, which are believed to have very detrimental effects on young people and their behavior. And at the very least, it can be seen as simply a waste of time, something that is just pointless in itself. And in fact, even our research here at the University of York by Sebastian Dededing, he's looked at this about how people justify their experience of playing games. And amongst adults, it's very common to essentially declare it to be something of a guilty pleasure. Nonetheless, here at York, we have the EPSSC Centre for Doctoral Training in Intelligent Games and Games Intelligence, or IGGI for short. We're looking at the richness of games, and we're looking at how they could be good for society and how computer science in particular, but other technologies might be used to improve digital games. So we're very excited about digital games here at York. Well, why is that? Well, actually, games are a really important part of modern society. For instance, take some statistics from the UK Interactive Entertainment Organisation, a sort of industry governance and overview organisation for all of the games industry. They tell us that in the last year, 86% of 16 to 69-year-olds played at least once a digital game. And in fact, 54% of people played on most days. So that's over half the population of adult population is playing a game on most days. And you may think, well, actually, that still could just be lots of young people, particularly teenagers and teenage boys playing. Well, that's not true. Half of the people who are playing on most days, they're over 40. And half of the people are also men and or women. So there's both genders fully represented in all age groups as well. As a consequence of this, the UK games industry is huge. It's estimated about £5.35 billion per year at the moment as the games market. And it's making a direct contribution of £1.5 billion to the annual economy. And it employs around 20,000 people who are related directly to the game development and the publishing of games. So it's not surprising, here's this quote from Noreen Carmody, the chair of IGGI and former chair of the steering committee of IGGI, where she says that the UK games industry is a global success story. And moreover, the UK games companies are hungry for the kind of research and highly skilled graduates that IGGI provides. Of course, just because something's popular doesn't mean that it's good. You know, so we're here at York, we're very interested in researching it, but we could be researching something quite not very nice. For instance, you know, betting is a very common thing, it's very popular, but I'm not sure it's the kind of thing we should be investing a lot of academic research in. But we need to be careful as well. Just because games have a bad press doesn't mean that they are automatically bad. For instance, if we go back in history, we'll find that similar things have been levelled against what we'd now consider a very respectable pastime, reading. Novels in their time have been considered as misleading versions of reality, leading to solitary and isolating behaviour, people sitting in a corner reading instead of talking, and of course representing immoral content, you know, terrible things like Madame Bovary, for instance, and therefore a waste of time. Okay, so these things are being levelled at probably every new technology and medium as it comes along. So let's have a proper think, and what I'd like to talk about is my understanding of player experience in digital games, and actually leading to the value that digital games have in modern society. So, how did I get here? Well, actually, I started life as a mathematician. I did my PhD in an area of pure mathematics, where in fact, nothing in my thesis could actually exist in this universe. So I've come a long way of getting into games, but how did I get into games? Well, I went off after my PhD, I went off to work as a software engineer, and from there I realized I was missing teaching, and so I got back into the academe, And at Middlesex University, I was hired as a lecturer and joined the Human-Computer Interaction Group, which is very lively, and I've still got some good friends and colleagues from that time. Human-computer interaction, HCI, is understanding how computers or digital systems more generally interact with us as humans and therefore enable us to achieve more, for instance, word processing or delivering drugs, but also to deliver experience such as, well, for instance, obviously playing games, but also connecting up with friends, learning about how the world works, and so on. So it's a huge area in the sense because digital technology is pervasive through modern life. However, how did I get into games? It really comes from a kind of almost a very straightforward question put to me by an MSc student at the time, Emily Brown, but way back in 2002. And she said, how come things like word processors just aren't as immersive as games? Well, that sounded like a really good question. You know, people really, really get into games and will put up all sorts of challenges and frustrations of playing games, where word processors just become more and more frustrating and challenging and nobody really enjoys using them. So how is it that games grab our attention, get us immersed and keep it in a way that other technology doesn't? Based on this question, I then decided to think it would be really good if we really try to understand that key term. What exactly is immersion? Through Emily's work and then on with other colleagues at the time at UCL and then subsequently here at York, we've thought very long and hard about what immersion is. And it seems to be that it's really about this sense of losing your awareness of the real world. As you play a digital game and become immersed, you lose your sense of what's happening around you. Related to that, you lose a sense of time. You don't have a clock in your head, but you kind of lose just any sense of the time is passing, what that means for time to be passing. And you become involved in the world of the game. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that the game has a world. Some games do, like Call of Duty and Need for Speed. They have a world that you can enter and occupy. But other games like Tetris and Monument Valley have worlds that you couldn't enter and occupy in the same way. But so when I talk about the world of the game, I mean the sort of that sense of being in the game and its artifacts, its features are totally consuming and involving your attention. So this is what we understood to be immersion. And of course, it's not unique to games. We get this in books, films, crocheting, knitting, whatever your hobby happens to be. But it seems to be that it's particularly important in digital games, and it's highly valued by players and often therefore highly talked about by reviewers and developers as something they want to achieve in their games. And so it was from this understanding of immersion and its value that I began to think about, well, what are other experiences that people have from playing digital games? And what values do they get out of that? What is important to them as a result of playing? When we do play digital games, we really do lose our sense of awareness. We escape into the game in some sense. Now, this may seem like, escaping is a fleeing word. We're running away from reality. And it may suggest it's sort of a lack of moral fiber in people who get obsessed and lost in their games. However, I would argue that it's quite valuable. If you look around at lots of literature around why people play digital games, what are their motivations, there's a lot of literature around this, and a lot of people have looked at this from all sorts of aspects and produced lots of different questionnaires about why people play games. Nathan Hughes, a PhD student of mine, he said, well, there's all these questionnaires. What do we do with them? What are the real motivations if there's all these different ways of understanding PLA's motivations? So he put the questionnaires all together and he got lots and lots of people to answer them. And from that, we were able to analyze what are all these different aspects of the player experience that motivate players to come in and play these games. And one of the key things that came from this is that people do seek escapism. But what was an interesting nuance, which we'd never seen before, that there were two ways in which people were escaping. In one sense, people are escaping from their day-to-day world, escaping from their problems, from adulting, and getting into the game as a distraction away from that, a rest, if you like, from the day-to-day worries, and somewhere where these worries weren't quite so immediate. I don't think it implied necessarily, therefore, that they never came back to their worries, but simply that it was a place to kind of shed some of your stresses and your day-to-day problems. And this resonates with work by Collins and Cox at UCL, where they realized that playing games afterwards was very important for post-work recovery at the end of a day, allowing you to go back to work refreshed and feeling better. But the other aspect that Nathan found was that we're not only escaping from the real world, sometimes we're escaping to this new other world, which is valued in itself because you can have magical, exciting adventures. Sometimes there are good stories, and sometimes they're just a really aesthetic and beautiful response. For instance, in The Legend of Zelda, Breath of the Wild, I don't know anybody who hasn't looked at it at some point going, wow, that's a really breathtaking view in the game. And people are looking for these moments of beauty and occasionally awe in their games. So escape isn't just a sort of a failure of people to deal with real life. However, when you come to think about other types of players from myself, people say who are identified as having a disability, we've been working with the charity called the Able Gamers Foundation based on the East Coast of America. And there you can see their mission statement. They're using the power of video games to bring people together and improve the quality of life with recreation and rehabilitation. It's really interesting to talk to players with disabilities because they many of them are able to play despite quite severe physical impairments or cognitive impairments and get valuable experiences. And so we are trying to understand, well, what is the value the players are getting from the games that they play, and why are they making such efforts to do so? So working with Chris Power, who was a colleague here at York at the time, but he's now at the University of Prince Edward Island in Canada, Jen Beeston, who's a PhD student and now a lecturer here at York, and with the good folks from Able Gamers, we set out to ask players what it is that they get from the game. And we didn't just ask about their players with disabilities. We also asked other people that Able Gamers came across, because they're present at games conferences and things like that, about their experiences. So we got this idea of people who identify as having a disability, what they value in the games, and also players who do not identify as having a disability and what they get from the games. And when we talked to them, we found all sorts of things. We found, of course, like Nathan had identified, people escape to some extent from their day-to-day worries. One thing that came through strongly from players with disabilities is that they use games to manage their pain. We never really understood what this actually meant. It seems to be quite important. It comes up reasonably regularly, but we don't really know what they're saying or how games are helping in that management of pain, and that's something we'd really like to look to in future. All players give all sorts of values, interesting escapism and art and things, but one thing that came through, particularly from the players who identified as having a disability, was that they felt enabled. When they were playing games, we were putting on a level playing field with other players, and as a result of which they felt empowered, more capable, and less like they were disabled in the way that they are in the real world. If you take a social model of disability, what we're saying is really, no, people have impairments. I mean, I have impairments, I wear spectacles, but they're corrected for by my spectacles. And for some people, their impairments are not corrected for by society. For instance, a wheelchair user who meets a flight of steps into the Minster is disabled from entering the Minster. But a simple ramp is a way to make that person feel more enabled. And so the disability in that sense goes away. And so what's happening is that digital games, in some sense, because once people are able to play the game, they are enabled to play and they become just like every other player. And that's extremely important for people, particularly for players with disabilities. All players also talk strongly about the sense of social connection. And social connection is indeed extremely important. This comes up all over the gaming literature, where people feel connected to each other through playing games, whether this is in massively multiplayer online role-playing games like World of Warcraft, which is now rather old-fashioned, or MOBAs, battle arenas like Fortnite, or coming together to play esports. People are making connections. However, it's not always obvious that actually social interactions are important around almost all games. This game is Nekotsumi, Kitty Collector, a rather unusual game in that what you do is you set up a nice little garden that you can see on the left there, and then you switch off the game. And while the game is switched off, kittens might appear in your garden. Depends on how attractive you've made your garden. You switch back on the game and you see a kitten, you can take a photograph of it, and that's it. And all you're doing is collecting the full set of potential kittens, the screen on the right there showing your cat book of what you've collected. So this game is very peculiar because it's not like these ideas of immersive games where you get lost and the world around you disappears. This game happens when you're not playing the game. And working with Joe Cutting and David Gundry, two PhD students of mine, they investigated this game and tried to understand what was happening. What was the player experience? If people aren't immersed in the game, what are they doing? And what they found was that actually two really important factors were the social connections that people were making, whether that was online with people by sharing through social media and their networks, or in person, literally showing each other the kittens that you've got. These two different aspects were quite independent, but that strong socialization around the game was a crucial part of the experience that people valued. So I hope through these three examples of my work, you get the sense that that initial view of games as being a bad thing is really not held up. Players value these games in all sorts of interesting ways. They extend players' experiences into worlds that are valued and appreciated as possibly even as works of art. They bring about real social connections. And for our players with disabilities, they bring opportunities that they weren't getting in the real world. Games are intrinsically valuable to a large part of modern society. And it's for that reason we've actually produced the IGGI. We've set up IGGI as the Centre for Doctoral Training because we're recognising that games are complex, socially important, and actually individually important. And so here you see the good folks of IGGI, obviously filmed a couple of years ago when you're allowed to be that close together for a photograph. And this is just a fraction of all of the people that we're training through the Doctoral Training Centre to become highly skilled and innovative researchers who could support the games industry. And all of the people I've talked about today, I've worked with today, the PhD students were all from this IGGI centre. So, but they're really only just scratching a fraction of what IGGI can actually do. If we look towards the future, some people in IGGI are looking at AI and how, for instance, artificial intelligence can be put into games, perhaps to give more meaningful interactions with the characters you might find in games. Link, a key character in the Zelda games, is essentially a cartoon character who doesn't really interact with you in a personal, meaningful way. But it's possible that he could if he was given some intelligence and some understanding of what would make a meaningful interaction. We're also using machine learning to understand the data that's coming from playing. People are pressing keys, moving, making choices all the time. Why are they doing that and how are they doing that? And in some sense, we've already found that they can lead to understanding aspects of people's personality, how they play, just through the actions that they take in the game. So the future of games is looking very exciting, and I hope I've managed to give you a sense of that. And do keep an eye out for IGGI, because I think we've got a lot more exciting things to come from them. I'd like to thank everyone who's contributed to this work, particularly those mentioned there, and thank you for your attention.